in lecture 16. And this lecture was given many years ago by Professor Lewin, and there is still a strong discussion whether he was right or wrong. Now, it's time to disclose what was really happening. And I want to prove that the statements of Professor Lewin are not valid and only based on a measurement error. Indeed, Professor Lewin is a very talented teacher, but the super demo he has been given was obviously not the best. So let's have a look into his model. Here we see his famous loop with an induced EMF of 1 volt. He never really measured this open loop EMF, so we have to accept that it was so. And this is already very strange. You see the two resistors. One is 100 ohm, the other one on the right, 900 ohms. And consequently, we'll have an induction current of 1 milliampere. This is Ohm's law. Now, Professor Lewin, he claims that when he connects two identical voltmeters or oscilloscopes between the same points D and E, that they can demonstrate different values of minus 0.1 volt and plus 0.9 volts. And this looks impossible, at least for me, and I think I'm not alone. It's not necessary to use a so-named supercoil and to create a transient in it. Instead, I'm using a simple ironless rectangular coil from a dynamo. And I do not know the exact number of windings, but when I connect this coil to my sine generator at 50 kHz, I know it represents an impedance of 200 ohms, and I need about 16 volts with an output impedance of 50 ohms to have sufficient DFIDT. The scope is triggered on this driver signal. And you can see it as the yellow trace on my second channel. And I can adjust the sine top exactly in the middle of the screen. And this makes it easier to compare the phase relationship between the different EMFs. This is my single loop secondary. And you see, when I approach the primary winding, an EMF is induced in this single loop. This is the schematic of the single loop secondary. Let's define some additional points in the loop. For example, B, C, E, and F. This will make it much more convenient to follow. First of all, we can measure the EMF inside the loop. We can do it just by opening the loop, for example here, and inserting an oscilloscope or a voltmeter between the two open points. And the result should be 1 volt. I must adjust the driver voltage up to about 16, 17 volts in order to become the desired 1 volt EMF in the secondary loop. This is the first measurement on the open loop. You see here that I open it on point B, and now I can adjust the driver so as to become a 1 volt peak to peak open EMF voltage. When I close the loop, I will measure directly across the resistor R2. You see the changing in voltage, open, close, open, close. Now, we will make a walk around the single loop. As you can see, it consists of two copper conductors. On the left side we have the 100 ohms, on the right side we have the 0.9 kilo ohm. We start in B as reference and we measure between B and A. What is the result? About 0.25 volt. This is the first EMF that we are measuring. If we go further between A and C, again we have another EMF of 0.25 volts. Now we are measuring directly across the resistor of 100 ohms between the points E and C. And we have the voltage drop of minus 0.1 volt. Between E and D, again we have the same value, the same 0.25 volts EMF. And the same we have between D and F. On the paper, we find first the two EMFs of each 0.25 volts. Then we meet a voltage drop across the resistor of minus 0.1 volt. Again, two EMFs of each 0.25 volts. And finally, we'll have a voltage drop inversely of minus 0.9 volts. We see that the sum of the EMFs equals 1 volt. It's equal and opposite to the voltage drop in the resistors. This is also 1 volt, but minus 1 volt. And this is very evident, because we know this from Kirchhoff. So please do not blame him. Do not blame him, because what is he telling us? When you walk around a loop, the sum of all the EMFs and all the voltage drops is always zero. And this law is not only valid for circuits containing batteries and resistors, but also for EMF and resistor circuits. Now, let's look between the points D and E. And we will walk in the left direction, this way, and then in the right direction, just as Professor Lewin did it. We start in A, then go to left, and we become in point C. We become 0.25 volts. From C to E, we have minus 0.1 volt. Between E and D, we become plus 0.25 volts. This makes a sum of plus 0.4 volts between E and D. Of course, we can do it from D to E, and then we will become minus 0.4 volts. And then we do another walk. We walk to the right, starting in A, and we go to D. And we become also 0.4 volts. We'll do it. Here we have minus an EMF of 0.25. Then we have a drop of plus 0.9. We become in F. And then we have a minus EMF of 0.25. And again, we have the same sum. Again, we have 0.4 volts between A and D. So this is independent of the way that you walk, left or right. It's always 0.4 volts. These are the values that we found in a left walk, starting in A, by applying Kirchhoff, plus 0.4 volts. This is the right walk, The result is also plus 0.4 volts in D. And this is what Professor Lewis pretends to see or to measure. When we walk left, he says he has minus 0.1 volt. When he walks right, 0.9 volts plus. Where is the mistake? Because his model has never been showed clearly, we can only imagine about it, but we can make a first supposition. Maybe he made a real note with the points C, A and B, and so they become one physical point. But you see, in this configuration there is no more an EMF in the lower part, there is only an EMF in the upper part of the loop. It should be half the value, but let's suppose it's 1 volt too. This means that in F you will have a plus 0.9 volt, in E we will measure minus 0.1 volt. And this is exactly what he found. If we now redraw the circuit, we see something very familiar. Just to say it with his own words, what a loss of time. Professor Ilouwen, he reinvented the transformer of his friend Faraday with an EMF of 1 volt and with two load resistors in a voltage divider configuration. I'm sure, I think this was not what he hoped to find. There is also a second suggestion, and I told it already in my first reply to him. We must consider that we are measuring small EMFs with an open wiring to the oscilloscope. And this means that there is not a magnetic shield around the wires, and the active sense wire of the probe, together with the return wire, the croco, they are forming an additional loop with half the length of the main loop. So let's call this the extra loop besides the main loop. And indeed, this loop is unwanted. It should be avoided. And we can do that by choosing a correct orientation of our measuring plane, namely vertical to the loop plane, which is horizontal. This is the only correct way to do it, because then the cosinus of the inducing field is zero. So what is the situation now? Our measuring system has a potential error of 50% because of the extra loop. It has half length of the main loop. And so I will demonstrate that this explains completely the super mistake. We come to the final solution of this worldwide scene phenomenon. This is the representation of the main loop together with the extra loops formed by the probe wires. And Professor Lewin, he states that he really used the points A and D, and that he flipped the wiring of the two identical voltmeter oscilloscopes to the left and then to the right, and that he measures two different values. We know that the voltage between D and E, if it is correctly measured, will be 0.4 volts. So we have to put our probes vertical between these two points, and then we will measure the correct value. There is no discussion about this. Now, if Professor Lewin flips one voltmeter together with the wiring to the left, then he creates an extra unwanted loop. And on this loop we see an additional EMF of 0.5 volts, which is half the value of the total EMF in the main loop. And the positive charges are pointing to the minus pole of the voltmeter. This means that the EMF of 0.5 volts opposes with the 0.4 volts from the main loop, and therefore it is to be subtracted from it. And it results in minus 0.1 volt. And that is precisely what he also got, but it is done with an incorrect measurement method. When he flips the other voltmeter with the wiring to the right, then he creates again an unwanted extra loop, and this EMF in this loop is also 0.5 volts, but as the negative charges of this extra loop are pointing to the minus terminal of the voltmeter, we must subtract a negative value. It turns in an adding operation, and consequently the voltmeter will show 0.4 minus minus 0.5, and this is plus 0.9 volts. Again, we have a result that we become with a wrong measurement method. I'll demonstrate this. I am between the points A and D, and I'm in a vertical position with my probes, so I have no flux coming through this loop. What I'm measuring is exactly the 0.4 volts between A and D. When I go to the left, looks what's happening. The extra loop will give me about minus 0.1 volt negative. When you go to the right, we have plus 0.9 volts. When we now go to the left, you can see we have about 0.1 volt negative, minus. To the right, we have about plus 0.9 volts. Here we have a vector visualization of the measurement with the arrows caused by the extra loops. They are in blue. The main EMF is in red. The voltage drops are in green. And look at the diagram. When we start in E and we go to D, we have first an EMF, then a voltage drop across the small resistor, again an EMF, and we come to 0.4 volts in D. This is the correct value. If you take into account the error voltage of the extra loop, we will drop down to minus 0.1 volt. This is an error. Same thing for the right loop. When we start in E, first we have an inverse EMF, then a big voltage drop across the right resistor, again an EMF inverse, and we have 0.4 volts. When we take into account the error voltage caused by the extra loop, we come out to 0.9 volts. This is not correct. Conclusion: the method was completely wrong. But the values are the same values that could be found by measuring directly across the two resistors. If you want to measure simultaneously with two oscilloscopes on the left and on the right resistors, then we must do it in a floating way, for example with differential probes to avoid ground interconnections. But the fact that Professor Lewin found similar values between D and E with a wrong method, the same values as we can find directly across the resistors with the correct method, this is clearly accidental. And I will demonstrate it. So this is the setup with the two equal resistors of 1 kilo ohm, and I'll put the probe as vertical as possible, and I'll have about, it's difficult to adjust, zero in this position. When I flip to the left, I become minus 0.5 volts. When I flip to the right, I become plus 0.5 volts. So this is very clear, I think. And finally, what can we learn from this confusing lecture? First of all, when something is very evident, it is not necessary to disturb students' intuition by invoking the non-conservative field theories. Because this is what magicians are doing. They misguide our intuition with distracting information. Secondly, regain your self-confidence and tell your grandchildren that the super demo sometimes becomes a super mistake. And finally, and most important to you, Professor Lewin, I declare my enormous respect for your teaching talent. But I hope that at the end you will agree with me and say that Kirchhoff is right, also in this case. Remember, we are all human, so we may commit mistakes. And surely, as a professor, you do have a more fundamental insight in science. But sometimes, a simple engineer can have a more practical one. Together, we can be strong. However, I will continue following all your lessons. Thank you very much for this, in love for physics, and in full admiration for the beauty of the creation. Thank you.